Union Square Kids Audio presents Rare Birds, written by Jeff Miller, read by Graham Halstead. My waiting room. Brains are weird, right? I can be sitting here in seat 25A of this airplane, surrounded by strangers and my mom, and if I close my eyes, I can be transported to a totally different place. In a split second, I can go somewhere breathtaking, like the top of the world's tallest mountain, or the sandy, sunburnt valley of the hottest desert, or Buffalo, New York, where my favorite restaurant of all time serves the world's best broccoli cheddar soup bread bowl. Brains even allow you to go to each amazing spot all at once. I can see myself now, up on top of the tallest mountain, overlooking the planet's hottest desert, lounging in a hot tub-sized bread bowl. Okay, the soup part would be gross, but you get the idea. The truth is, even though my brain could take me magical places, it spends most of its time in one place. I call it my waiting room. Welcome. I come here whenever I'm feeling not quite bored and not quite lonely and not quite sad. It's the place my imagination carries me to whenever I'm feeling in between, which is a lot these days. Now that you're here with me, let me show you around. In many ways, my waiting room is just like one you'd find in every other hospital. It has the same vending machines filled with old candy nobody ever buys, the same uncomfortable chairs that constantly wobble, and the same stacks of old magazines. Oh, and there's a TV that never plays anything good. There are also two doors. Behind one door is a miracle, and behind the other door is a disaster. A disastrous disaster. That's the crummy thing about hospital waiting rooms. You're only ever in them to see which type of news you're about to get. Either way, your life is going to be changed forever. My job is to wait. And wait. And wait. And wait. And let me tell you, it's not easy to wait to see if your mom is going to live or die. I feel my ears begin to adjust to a change in pressure, so I open my eyes. I'm back in seat 25A, flying from Buffalo to Miami. Like I said, brains are weird. Next destination. Ladies and gentlemen, we are beginning our final descent. My stomach lurches looking out the window as we make a wide turn over the glimmering ocean. Swamps and houses and swimming pools grow closer until I can almost make out the ant-sized people lounging around them. Local time in Miami is 7:52 p.m. on this first day of June with a temperature of 88 degrees. Now we know y'all can choose anyone to fly with, so from everyone on the flight crew, thank you for flying with us, and we'll see you next time, I say, along with the pilot. I've pretty much got the whole boarding and deboarding routine memorized, start to finish. Sometimes the flight crew will give suggestions about where to go in your new destination, too. In Buffalo, they tell you the best places to order chicken wings. In Seattle, it's the best place to get a fresh fish thrown at you really, really hard. Everything else stays the same, though. My mom nudges me with her elbow. She points out the window at the beach below. It looks just like the pictures I've seen on my mapping app, a road of sand and sunshine that runs the length of Florida, blue water practically lapping at its shoreline. I can almost see the sunburns and drinks with frilly umbrellas. Is that mini golf course you worked at down there somewhere? I ask, peering down at the road dotted with beaches. Oh, I think they tore that down a while ago. I bet it's a restaurant or a doctor's office now, she replies, leaning back into her seat. Those summers were the best. Me and Dom would spend $20 on arcade games trying to win fake sunglasses. We called them Roy Bonds, Mom says with a chuckle. The plane makes a sharp turn and my stomach drops. "And who exactly is Dom again?" I say, turning to her. I usually like to know a guy before hopping in his van. Can never be too careful. Mom laughs, pulling her hair to one side. "You'll love him. We grew up together here in Sugarland." The landing gear unfolds and the plane touches down with a few soft bounces. This is officially the fourth city we've been to since my 10th birthday, the day it all started. We were in Chicago when we rushed to the hospital in the back of an ambulance, my ice cream cake still in the freezer. It was the first time I saw her like that, scared and surrounded by wires and machines. From Chicago, we went to Seattle, then Minneapolis for, 3 months, and finally to Buffalo for most of last year, which was actually cool. Mom and I both made friends there, which made it harder to leave. Each new place is exactly the same, with new doctors and surgeons and hospital officials saying they have got the answer to all our problems. Well, my mom's problems. I'm just along for the ride. They've always got the best doctors or the newest hospitals or most cutting-edge treatments. Only none of them have worked. After all this moving around, we're still no closer to a cure. So far, we only have a diagnosis: dilated cardiomyopathy. It took a while to learn how to spell it. Basically, it's where somebody's heart gets very sick and can barely do what it needs to do to keep them alive. Then, when it's too tired, it starts beating out of control. Like so out of control that it could kill you. The only way to stop that is to blast somebody in the chest with those paddles you see on TV shows. My mom has a device inside of her that does the blasting, so she doesn't need somebody standing around shouting, "Clear!" But the doctors down here in Florida, they say they've got an answer. They say that since her heart is failing, she needs a new one, a transplant, and that it's our only option left. This time, I might believe them, because if a new heart won't fix my mom, I don't know what will. Mom says once we leave here and she's all better, we can finally go home, whichever home we want that to be. I want it to be Buffalo. "Here we go, G," says Mom as the airplane crawls to a stop on the runway. "It all happens for a reason." I slip my hand into my mom's and squeeze it. Half the battle. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking that it stinks to move around a lot, and it stinks to leave your friends behind, and it stinks to have a mom who's sick. You might even be saying, "Wow, Graham, does your life always stink?" And I don't know. Maybe you're right. But if you tell my mom that her life stinks, she'll just tell you, "It all happens for a reason." Like most coaches for professional sports, my mom believes in the power of a good saying, a motto, a mantra. So that's why she'll say, "It all happens for a reason," roughly 300 billion times a day. Her doctors have their own sayings, like, "Hang in there, slugger," and, "Being positive is half the battle." But sometimes I want to scream, "What about the other half?" I know what happens on the other half of the battle, and I can tell you no one has any sayings over there. Anyways, I'm trying to stay positive. I promise. Welcome to Sugarland. "It's going to work this time, Grammy," she tells me as the seatbelt light turns off with a ding. Everyone around us stands up, reaching for carry-on items and picking their wedgies. I nod. Just the thought of somebody cutting into me and, replacing my pinky nail gives me chills. But a heart? "Remember that afternoon in Seattle when we first left the hospital?" Mom asks. "When there was basically a monsoon out of nowhere and we had to walk half a mile to our car," I reply. Exactly. And we started to run, and we were soaked and cold. But then we just started laughing, she says with a smile. And we jumped in every puddle we saw. And then that golden eagle swooped right over us and landed on the roof of our car, I say, the memory coming back vividly. If my phone wasn't totally soaked, I would have had the best photo ever. I can still remember the sparkling gold flecks in its brown eyes. Seeing what others don't, your superpower, Mom chuckles. Not to brag, but I'm pretty good at noticing little details that might slip past other people. Like when a pet dog looks exactly like their owner, or when somebody doesn't remember words to a song and tries to mumble along without someone else hearing. I always do. This weirdly helps in getting photos of birds, too. My mom loves, and I mean loves, bird watching. She never takes their pictures, though, no matter how rare the bird. She believes birds are like spirits who have passed away, and each one is coming to say hello. She never wants to scare them off. Some real mom stuff, if you ask me. We step into the crowded airplane aisle and shuffle forward. That day in Seattle is a good reminder, G, that sometimes when life is nothing but puddles, you end up with a bird of prey on top of your sedan, I joke. And I don't know why, but this makes us both crack up. And once we start, it's hard to stop. My mom is really good at that. The flight attendant smiles at us as we pass. Her name tag says Lindsay, same as my mom's name. Did you see that? It all happens. Mom, you're reaching your limit for the day, I say as we step off the plane. For a reason, Mom smiles. The humidity surrounds us like the hot breath from a dog. Welcome to Sugarland. The Blue Beast. The radio of Dom's ancient, faded blue van is playing a Tom Petty song full blast. He's one of my mom's favorites, so I've heard it before. Every window is down, and my mom's hair is whipping around her face as she sings along. It's like the mom I knew has suddenly gotten a factory reset and is once again a 17-year-old. Ka-chunk! The van hits a pothole, and I grip the door handle super tight. The entire vehicle feels like it might fall into pieces at any given moment. I'm behind Dom, sharing the back bench seat with a stack of paintbrushes, a warm energy drink, and a handful of CDs by a group called Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young. The name sounds like a group of lawyers or orthodontists. I can't believe this van still works, Mom says, running a hand over the vehicle's faded dashboard. I'm pretty sure you drove me to high school in this thing. The Blue Beast, Dom says from the driver's seat, his arm out the window. He pats the side of the door like he would a beloved pet. Still running like a top. Dom has a toothpick in the corner of his mouth and is wearing a white t-shirt and paint-splattered white overalls. His forearm hair is speckled with multicolored paint drops. He looks like a man-size Easter egg. So how have you been, Dom? What's new? My mom asks. Oh, you know me. Same dirt, different shirt, Dom answers as he eyes the rearview mirror in his bulky silver sunglasses, the kind that are only worn by outfielders and fishermen. I hear you're turning 12 end of this summer, Graham. You play any sports or anything? He asks. Soccer, I guess, I reply. Graham was going to try out for the team back in Buffalo before we left, Mom adds from the passenger seat. Nice, Dom says. This your first time to Florida, then? First time I remember being here, at least. Graham wasn't even 2 years old when we moved to Chicago, Mom says. I'm pretty sure the earliest memory I have is of me and my mom dipping the back tires of our car into Lake Michigan once we got there. She said it was tradition. Apparently, my dad used to do that before and after every trip. I just remember being really excited, and also nervous that we might get stuck. "Your dad was a good man," Dom says, almost like he's reading my mind. "A real good guy." "Thanks," I say. My dad died when I was 1.5. Everyone says he was a good guy. Such a good guy that he died trying to save some people during a hurricane. Sometimes I secretly wish he was a less good guy and a more alive guy. But mostly, thinking about my dad just makes me extra glad I've got my mom. We're all each other's got. I look out to see the clouds turn shades of pink and blue. I don't know why, but the soapy hues make me feel calm, as though it's the sun's way of telling us everything is going to be okay, that maybe Sugarland is the miracle we've been waiting for. Gators. "Home sweet home," Dom says as we pull onto a long gravel road that winds through gnarly, old-looking trees. Their huge, crooked branches are covered with stringy moss and loom over us. We eventually exit the slightly spooky tree tunnel and stop in front of a freshly painted ranch house. It's small, and besides the new coat of light yellow paint, it seems like nothing about it has been changed in decades. Ivy is growing up the side of the stone chimney, and the address numbers on the red front door are cracked and splintered from years of sun. Behind the house is a perfectly trimmed lawn that's surrounded by wild swampland. Twisted trees poke out in all directions, trying to overtake the wooden fences marking the border of the yard. Dom pushes the garage door controller on the visor. After a pause, the white wooden garage door gently creaks open. A calico cat runs out from a bush next to the garage, briefly mewing before darting off. "For the record, everybody, that cat is a liar. Don't ever trust it," Dom says, turning off the van in the driveway as the garage door finishes opening. "And be alert, Graham. Gotta keep an eye out for the gators." My palms sweat. "Gators?" "Oh, you probably won't see any," Dom says with a wink. "Probably." "Wait, seriously?" I shout. But he and my mom are already stepping into the garage. An unwelcome stranger. I sit for a few seconds, gazing at the tangled wilderness 20 yards away. I remind myself there's probably not a family of hungry swamp monsters waiting for me. There totally, definitely isn't. Totally, definitely. I take a deep breath and hop out of the van. I walk into the garage where a light bulb is buzzing overhead, revealing a museum of old ladders and fishing poles. Dom starts emptying his van of paint cans and drop cloths, piling it next to boxes with Lindsay scrawled on their side. "Oh, Dom, I didn't realize it was so much stuff," Mom says, looking at the mountain of boxes from my grandma's old place. She moved out west to live with my aunt a few years ago when she couldn't really take care of herself anymore. Dom's been holding on to Mom's stuff since then. "We can get this sorted right away." She walks over to one of the boxes, unfolds the flaps, and begins to sift through. "I didn't know what you'd want to hang on to, so I just saved it all," Dom says. "Your mom really had a thing for whales, huh?" I watch my mom reach into a cardboard box and pull out a sign in the shape of a whale making a winky face. "Whale come to our home," it reads. "Wow, I haven't seen some of this stuff in years and years." "Well, it'll still be there tomorrow. Let's go see what we've got to fix up for dinner," Dom tells her. "You know what I've been craving?" Mom says. "Swanson's." Dom laughs. "I'm sure you have. In high school, you couldn't go 3 days without going there." What's Swanson's? I ask. Swanson's is only the best place in the world, Graham Dodds, Mom says. Just imagine a burger with the ultimate secret recipe sauce, a chocolate peanut butter shake that's impossible to drink with a straw, a bag full of fries that's so greasy you can see right through it. I nod my head. These are all impressive food groups. Then it's settled. Swanson's it is, Mom says with glee. For you guys, at least. My doctors probably get alerts whenever I'm within 50 feet of a hamburger. We can at least sneak you a few fries, Linz. I'll come with, but you're in charge of the blue beast from here on, Dom says as he tosses my mom the keys. It's a nice night for a ride. You coming, Graham? A breeze of warm Florida air rushes around us. Even after the sun sets, it's somehow still hot. Actually, would you mind if I hung out here and took a shower? Course not. There's a towel on your bed, Graham, Dom says. Tell Nick to call in the order. We can do the family combo with a veggie wrap for your mom. I tilt my head, confused. Wait, who's Nick? I ask. Nick's my boy, about your age too, Dom says. Tell him I said to turn off the TV and show you around. Oh, cool, I reply. I shoot a quick, perplexed glance at my mom. She didn't tell me that Dom had a son. Why would she leave that out? She just grins at me as though to say, isn't this the best surprise ever? I widen my eyes back as though to say, not really. Go in through the back. You'll see a sliding glass door around the garage, Dom says with a pointed finger. Mom gets behind the wheel of the van. You sure I can drive this thing? She asks. You're fine. You just gotta give it the business to get it started, Dom says. Mom gives it some gas and it roars to life. She gives the engine a few quick revs with an electric smile. We'll be right back, Graham, she says. Have fun, I reply, with only a touch of sarcasm. I add a thumbs up for good measure. Staying positive, technically. And son. Hey, Dad, says a voice from nowhere as I step into the sparsely decorated living room. Two leather recliners face a giant TV. A blue couch is pushed all the way into the corner and seems to be used as more of a coat rack slash mailbox. The TV is playing a professional wrestling match. Hey, I'm Graham, I say over the sounds of body slams. Are you Nick? Your dad told me to ask you to order the family meal at Swanson's. A recliner spins around and Nick stares back at me. He's a little chubby and has a buzz cut that's growing out. He's very tan and wearing a faded t-shirt that says Dom and Son Painting in cursive writing. So, you're the person who's sharing my room then, he says. From his scowl, it seems he isn't happy about it. Huh, I guess I didn't realize I was sharing a room with anybody. That's, cool though, I say. Most everywhere we've been, the hospitals have helped set us up with a two-bedroom apartment, so I'm not exactly used to the idea of a roommate. Just don't touch any of my stuff and stay out of my way, Nick says, pulling out his phone. No prob, I assure him. And my mom wants a veggie wrap. I'll take a burger plain. I hate mustard and mayo. I listen as Nick places the order for pickup. He talks using very few words, saying okay and family meal for four over and over to the person on the other end of the call. We'll take a veggie wrap too, and make sure there's extra mayo and mustard on all the burgers. Thanks, Nick says as he ends the call and walks into the bathroom. I sigh, rolling my eyes to the bumpy-looking ceiling. Nick is a bully. Got it. I know about bullies. The first week we lived in Seattle, they had that day where parents come in and talk about their jobs, but my mom was stuck in the hospital. She came in a week later and did a presentation on her full-time job, getting better. She borrowed a bunch of stuff from the hospital, including an IV bag and stethoscope. It was pretty cool. But after that, the guys in my class started calling me Patient Zero. I glance around the rest of the house. It looks stuck in time, like nobody's done anything to it in years. There aren't any family photos or anything, and all the carpet is shaggy and lime green. I walk toward the kitchen, briefly looking down the dark hallway that I figure leads to the bedrooms. The kitchen floor is covered with old, multicolored tiles, and there are a couple of bags of recycling filling up in the corner. The counter is covered with empty donut boxes, and it all smells like old coffee. The stove is huge and white, and looks more like an incinerator than something to cook with. Same with the fridge. They both look like they might run off coal or steam or whatever was used in the 1800s. Nick lumbers into the kitchen, opens the refrigerator, and pours himself a glass of orange juice. "I hear you're sick," he says, slugging back his juice. He wipes his mouth with the back of his hand. "I'm not actually sick. It's my mom." "Oh," says Nick. Even barefoot, he's about 3 inches taller than me. He leaves his glass on the counter. "Mind if I go to your room?" I ask, changing the subject. "I need to put down my backpack and charge my phone." "Down the hall, the last door on the right. I'm going to finish my show," he says, returning to his chair. "You know, my dad's really helping you guys out, you being so in the way and everything." I feel my stomach drop. I hate feeling like I'm in anybody's way. "What do you mean?" I ask and clear my throat. "I just don't see why we have to be the ones suffering," Nick says before turning the volume on the TV back up. I head toward my new bedroom, but turn back toward Nick after a few steps. "Maybe we'll be helping you guys out. The kitchen might get cleaned for once," I say over the wrestling commentators. "What?" Nick says from his recliner. "Staying positive." "Nothing," I mumble as I continue to the bedroom. I step inside and shut the door. There's an old army cot with a University of Florida Gators comforter perched in the corner. I lie down on it, shutting my eyes. I let my thoughts drift away to my waiting room, and I remind myself this is what has to be done to help my mom. "Dinner's on, boys!" yells Dom a little while later. I hear the glass sliding door squeak shut. When I get to the kitchen, Dom and Nick are already digging in. Nick reaches into the bag, grabs his food, and brushes past me down the hallway without a word. "Sometimes he likes to be in his room by himself for a while. It's best to let him be," Dom says as he heads to his recliner. "Come grab a seat. Your mom's still out in the garage." He nods to the other open recliner that's aimed at the TV. It's now playing some baseball game. He unfolds the foil wrapper of his burger on the tiny wooden stand next to him. "I might go see how my mom's doing," I reply. "But thanks, though."
"Suit yourself,"
Dom says through a mouthful of food. I wrestle with the sliding door and step back outside, the nighttime heat welcoming me back. At least I'm welcome somewhere. A bestseller. With my disgusting mayo and mustard burger in one hand and a pouch of fries in the other, I go to the garage to find my mom sifting through her old belongings. "By the way, you didn't have to keep Nick a secret." I look my mom right in the eye, and her smile disappears. It's replaced with something that sort of looks like guilt. She lets out a long sigh. "I'm sorry, G. I should have told you about Nick. I'd hoped it'd be a fun change of pace, somebody your own age to hang out with? I know how hard it can be for you to make a real buddy. I didn't want you to be nervous. It's not that I can't make friends, I say as I near the mountain of junk. It's that moving around all the time makes it feel kind of pointless. I sit down next to her and think back to all the friends I've said goodbye to over the last 2 years. I have a long list of people I never talk to anymore. Graham, I'm really sorry, Mom says again, cupping the back of my head with her hand in the way that always makes me feel like a little kid. This is all so unfair to you. I pull open the clear tape on one of the many boxes in front of us. Find anything good? Nothing of interest yet. She winks at me. How are you doing, G? I'm sure this has been a lot to take in today, Mom says, tiny beads of sweat forming on her slightly wrinkled forehead. Nick okay? I shrug. I'm good. This place is cool. Sure, maybe it hasn't been cleaned in a couple years, but it's better than some hotel with little kids in wet swimsuits dripping all over the waffle station, I say, remembering the nights we've spent between housing situations. Mom smiles at me kindly. She knows when I'm putting on a good face. I'd hoped Dom had a spare room for you. I survived soccer camp last summer. This will be a breeze. That's my boy, Mom says. Never mind. I'm sure Nick's cool, I lie, looking around the garage. Piled in every corner are Harley motor parts, tools, and lots of Daytona 500 memorabilia. Think Dom's ever thought about selling any of this? I wonder aloud. I take a few steps toward a wall covered in posters of fancy-looking boats. Some of this stuff seems cool. Mom doesn't say anything, and I look back to see her pop up from deep inside a cardboard box mountain. What? She says enthusiastically. No way! No, I'm serious. The motorcycle stuff alone could get... Oh, sorry, G. Not that. Wow, she says, a mystified smile across her face. What is it? I ask, hoping to find an unlocked safe or pirate treasure. She pulls out a small, well-worn book instead. There isn't any cover art. I mean, there isn't even really a title or anything, so it's hard to tell exactly what it is. The pages are yellowed and worn like something you'd find in a museum. Wow, I can't believe it, Mom says, turning it over in her hands. Is it your diary or something? The Rare Birds of Florida, Mom says, the leather journal slightly cracking as she opens it. Am I supposed to know that one? A bestseller by Lindsay Dodds, she finishes. And again, I ask, what is it? It's, oh, I don't know. What me and Grandma Mabel used to do when I was young, Mom says. She turns it over in her hands. One summer, I was determined to find the 10 rarest birds in Florida. She passes it to me, and I open the cover to look at the first page. In sloppy cursive, it reads, Property of Lindsay. She crossed her T's and swooped her Y's in the exact same way that I do. I found 9 that summer. I never could find a snail kite. So, you've been a bird nerd your whole life then, huh? I say. Mom smiles, and I shut the book and try to hand it back over. Why don't you hang on to it for me, G? Mom says, reaching over to squeeze my hand. She returns to her pile of boxes as a gentle rain begins to fall outside. How does it feel to be home? I ask her after a while. I'm not really sure I can even call this place my home anymore. Driving around tonight, it's all different, she says, pulling out a high school yearbook and examining the cover. Want to see a picture of your dad? I nod, a familiar lump in my throat. I try not to think about my dad too much, to be honest. I don't remember him really, so I don't know why thinking about him makes me feel sad. She points to a picture of a guy who looks like a bizarro version of me. He's older and taller, but still gangly like me. The lump in my throat bobs as I swallow. Seeing this picture reminds me that I've already lost one parent and could lose another. Before my cheeks get red, I blink a few times and look down. Mostly, I don't think about the fact that my dad died, but when I do think about him, it feels like someone is squeezing my neck and my heart and my brain all at the same time. He was so handsome. Like you, she says, ruffling my hair. Now come on, let's head in before the bugs eat us alive. This is new. Wakey, eggs and bakey, says a voice at the door of my, well, I guess Nick's room. It's Dom, leaning in from the hallway. He's wearing a neon tank top that's covered in logos from a local surf shop. He has a ridiculous tan line on his arms from his t-shirts, like he's wearing a bright white shirt under his tank. I should be wearing sunglasses as a precaution. Thanks, Dom, I say, wiping the sleep from the corners of my eyes. I can hear the sound of bacon crackling on a pan as the smell of it fills the air around me. Getting breakfast going. First day of practice for tryouts. Got to be in fighting shape. Nick groans as his dad heads back into the hallway. What are you practicing for? I ask as I get up and make my bed. Maybe in a half-asleep state, Nick won't be a total monster. Why do you care? Nick says glumly. A monster at all hours, turns out. Sometimes I remind myself that most people are good and maybe are going through something tough. But right now...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.